So if you imagine like this is the entrance of your vaginal canal, it usually gives pain pretty much in the middle. And okay. If that's where you have pain, that's it can definitely be your pudendal nerve.
That makes a lot of sense. We had a couple of really specific questions about techniques that people are aware of that might be used in pelvic floor physical therapy. One was myofascial release. Someone asked if you could share your opinion about that and whether you think there's enough evidence to support that.
So my answer may not please everyone, and I'm okay with that. So I have to be honest there. So I'm quite evidence-based, and this may sound a little bit arrogant on my part, and I'm terribly sorry for that. But I do believe that your pelvic floor was designed to squeeze and to relax at will. I don't feel like myofascial release will actually respect also the principle that I was talking before, which is, if you have pain, your pelvic floor will react against it. What I see a lot of people, how can I say, after myofascial release, unfortunately, a lot of people flare. They have a lot more pain than they actually had before. And my problem is, why would the physiotherapist induce pain to get rid of pain? It doesn't make a lot of sense to me. And I don't think the physiotherapy should be painful. Another reason as well is that I feel that pain during treatment, and myofascial release usually is uncomfortable, inducing pain during treatment in the long run, for me, it also induces that feeling of I have to go to my physio to release my pelvic floor. And I feel like physiotherapists should be giving independence to my patients. And that's why I'm such a big fan of biofeedbacks, because biofeedbacks tell you how you can squeeze and how you can relax and how you can maintain that relaxation at will, which is pretty much what your pelvic floor was designed to do. I don't think going to a pelvic floor physiotherapist that will not teach you, but will push your pelvic floor into relax, will fix your problem. Because as soon as you leave your pelvic floor physiotherapist, your pelvic floor will do what it has been doing for many years, which is tightening up again. Mm-hmm. So in my opinion, myofascial release techniques create dependency. And it's great if you'd like to give a push to your pelvic floor physiotherapist. But if you're talking about long-term effects, I don't believe that myofascial release will really help with the problems with straining or recurrent UTIs. And another problem that it can do, it can re-traumatize the vaginal mucosa, which will pretty much create another way for bacteria to go in. So I don't think it would really be highly beneficial.
Okay. You talked about the biofeedback as something that can help people learn to do it themselves. Is there something that they can use at home in that way, or is that something that they would have to learn with you? Can you maybe talk about some of the devices that people could use?
Yeah. So if you are in Australia, there is a, I swear to you that I don't give any, I don't get any, I don't have any sponsorship or anything like that, but there is one brand called NeuroTrack Biofeedback, which is, it's not cheap, but it's not really expensive either. It's $400, but you can just take it. What I usually recommend is find a pelvic physiotherapist that uses biofeedback, because what we usually do is we rent them for you. So you take it for 3 weeks, and that's pretty much all you need, three, four weeks at most. You don't need it in the long term, but I do understand that some people like to having their own device because it can come back. However, you don't have to. Usually pelvic floor physiotherapists can rent it out for you.
Okay. And people also ask about the wands that you can use for release techniques. Is that myofascial release related, or is that something else?
Yeah, that's definitely myofascial release. It's the same principle as I was saying before. I have some problems with the wands, in particular because I feel that patients often, they want so much to get better that they overdo it. They can injure themselves as well. And I do feel because patients don't have... Well, in general, we don't have a big understanding of where the anatomy is. I've already seen patients putting pressure on the urethra and on the bowel, and those areas are not supposed to have pressure. I also feel like it creates a little bit of dependence, because I also see my patients doing things like, whenever I have pain, I do this. And I understand that at least gives them another way to feel like at least they feel like they can do something to get better. But my goal for them is for them to be able to relax by themselves without the need of a tool. So I feel as well that it creates a little bit of, it catalyzes pretty much the, I do believe people get injured. I don't think that it helps in the long run, and it will make people dependent on the wand.
Okay. That's interesting. Now, can we talk a little bit about the nerves and how this all works with the bladder and the pelvic floor? So the first question someone asked is, can a UTI irritate the nerves in the pelvic region? And that's what the issue might be, even if the infection has cleared.
Definitely. Definitely. And I love that question, because that's often what happens. And it's the same that happens with other conditions like endometriosis. Mm-hmm. Any condition around that area, particularly with pain, and a urinary tract infection often induces pain. So anything that induces pain, if your nervous system gets super wired, it can actually start creating pain or increasing its pain. And of course, it will depend on how bad was the infection, how many nerves were affected as well.
Can physical therapy help with that, or do you need to take a different approach?
No, definitely. Pelvic floor physiotherapy can help with that. We call it desensitization. We try to calm down the nervous system. And that's why it's so important that we stop doing the things we were doing before. For instance, if you have a big tendency of only going, like, let us imagine, like twice a day to the bathroom to empty the bladder, but you have a big tendency of having a liter and a half of water or fluids a day, that means that you're pushing your bladder into 700 mils daily, and that will not really help, because you're putting a lot of pressure on your bladder, putting a lot of pressure on your pelvic floor. And we can also do other things like making sure your pelvic floor is relaxing, making sure your tummy is being desensitized as well. Touch is amazing, and I understand why a lot of people use myofascial release. The only difference between touch and myofascial release is the amount of pressure you put. So we don't really use too much pressure at all. So desensitization can simply be touching regularly the area to just help your body to desensitize from pressure. Okay. Pretty much. And this is one thing we have all used for years and years in neurology.
Okay. So, and the next question was, can you explain what an entrapped genitofemoral nerve is and how long that condition usually lasts?
So it all depends. And the genital femoral nerve comes from T12. So T12 is like the 12 vertebra of your lower back, and it can go all the way to L1 and to L2. So if you have lower back pain, you can actually have that pain coming from the lower back. You can also have an irritation around the area. If you have a history of a lot of pain around, gut pain, or if you had surgery around the abdomen, that can also irritate the nerve, which can flare and give pain usually around the interior part, of the abdomen and the in the leg. However, I think it's really important as well to say is, not everything that is around that area is due to the genitofemoral nerve. So if we have problems in your gut, particularly, remember as well that around this area you have the ascending colon. Mm-hmm. So if you have bowel problems as well, it can give you the same type of pain, because the genitofemoral nerve is there, but it's not the only nerve. Mm-hmm. So I do feel like often the genitofemoral nerve is blamed for a lot of things that should be actually being addressed by gut, or even ovary. So if we think about that, the ovary is also here, that the ovary can also refer pain into this whole same area. So I do think we do need to just double check, why is that genitofemoral nerve angry? Could it be that you had like an accident and you had a direct hit around the T12 to L1 area? Or was it something more abdominal? Was it endometriosis, adenomyosis, irritable bowel syndrome, Crohn's disease, diverticulitis, or any other thing that happened? Or did you have abdominal surgery and the scar tissue is just impacting on the nerve as well?
I want to ask you a little bit more about post-surgery things like the scar tissue, but there's a few more things on nerves first. Someone asked if there's a connection between pelvic floor dysfunction, pudendal nerve entrapment, and frequent UTIs.
Interesting. So, well, I love the question. It's a hard question, a hard answer. So for pudendal, I do feel like we sometimes blame the pudendal nerve for a lot of things, but we can definitely have a pudendal neuropathy. Mm-hmm. Let us imagine after a birth in particular. So if we have a baby going through our vaginal canal, our pelvic floor has to go from this position to this position. As the baby's head, particularly if you have a very long second stage, which means the push phase, mm-hmm. that means that your baby is pushing on the sides of your pelvic floor for a very long time. That in itself can overstretch your pudendal nerve, which can refer pain usually into clitoral area in the middle of your right in the center of your vaginal vulva and like center of your vaginal canal. So if you imagine like this is the entrance of your vaginal canal, it usually gives pain pretty much in the middle. And okay. if that's where you have pain, that's it can definitely be your pudendal nerve. Pudendal nerve trauma after birth usually should heal around 6 months. Okay. And if it doesn't heal straight away, there are some things that we can do. Pelvic floor physiotherapy can definitely help because of a nerve that is very sensitized can act two ways, or a trauma in a nerve can act in two ways. Can either become very weak, because remember that the nerves of your pelvic floor are supplied by, are innervated by your pelvic, by your pudendal nerve. So if your pudendal nerve was overstretched, your pelvic floor can become weak, or it can go really protective. And that can definitely be something we need to work on. We also suggest estrogen cream to help the nerves, because we do know that estrogen cream helps with nerve regeneration. However, I do feel as well that have a lot of people that come to my practice and they were diagnosed with pudendal neuralgia and it wasn't pudendal okay. neuralgia. So I do feel like often, like it's almost like people only know one nerve of the pelvic floor, because if it's not in the middle, and I often have people that have pain on the side. Yeah. So pain on the side, it can be a femoral nerve. It can be so many other nerves. If it's more around the vulva, that's another nerve. So we do need to understand that pudendal nerve, if it's only pudendal nerve, usually it's a more central type mm-hmm. of pain. And it should improve if it's after birth. If it's not if it's not in that area, usually it's not the pudendal nerve, and it can be something else.
The estrogen cream in that case, is that for any stage of life, a male and female? Does it work in the same way, or is it just for specific patients that might help?
So particularly after birth and due to breastfeeding and the whole hormonal changes, our estrogens can decrease a lot. And if your estrogens are so low that you start having very sensitized pelvic floor, very irritated, the mucosa is really starting mm-hmm. to be quite white, and you have a lot of pain, estrogen can be prescribed to help with that pain. And to just also, the beautiful thing about estrogen is that it plumps the skin in a way. In the tissues, it's more like the tissues, and it helps with vascularization, and it just helps with the overall tissue quality as well. So if you have pain, it just makes the area less irritated, which really helps with pain. I've never seen it used in men. Yeah. I've never seen it using men. Yeah, no, it was a really good question, but I don't think it has been used with men. Mm-hmm. And I would probably we use more vaginal estrogen in cream for usually postmenopausal women or women right after birth, but in really specific cases, not for everyone.
Okay. Are there situations where you think a nerve block might be beneficial for patients that do have that kind of nerve pain?
Yeah, so definitely. So I do like to talk, of course, about pelvic floor physiotherapy, because it's one thing that we can always do that has no side effects in a way, if it's done properly. However, there are patients that do not improve with whatever therapy they are given, and a pudendal nerve block can definitely give them also more relief for some time. The problem as well is if we only have the pudendal block and we don't use that window of opportunity to help with the rest, mm-hmm. we are losing a very good opportunity to improve. Because remember, once the nerve block starts wearing off, you're going to have the same problems. Mm-hmm. So we want to make sure always that during that time where the pain levels are a little bit lower, we want to make sure that you're still trying to help your pelvic floor to at least allow that pudendal nerve to be under less pressure.
How long is that window of opportunity? Is it very short, or can it be months for some people?
It depends. Mm-hmm. So it can take 3 weeks for it to start having an effect. I've seen some blocks after 6 months to be gone.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So it really just depends on the person then.
Yeah.
Can you provide insight or an opinion on InterStim devices?
So eSTIM, yes, of course. So rule of thumb, I don't think that eSTIMs, the research on eSTIMs is actually pretty good. So they shouldn't harm you. Mm-hmm. If you're doing them correctly and if you are using it for the right purpose they were designed. Mm-hmm. So if your pelvic floor is already quite active, using eSTIMs is probably not where you want to go. If your pelvic floor is weak, or if your pelvic floor awareness is so low that you are not able to contract, to feel a squeeze when you contract and a relaxation, mm-hmm. eSTIMs can help you understand what is how a contraction is supposed to feel and how is it supposed to feel when you relax as well. So I feel like eSTIM are really good, particularly for people that do not know how to contract their pelvic floor. So I don't think that they are bad at all. What I do, I have to admit that as a pelvic floor physiotherapist, I always have the same rule that I like to obey, which is I want your pelvic floor to be able to contract when you need it and mm-hmm. to be able to relax when you need it. And I do feel like if you only do your eSTIMs, if you're doing it with the machine and you're trying to improve your awareness, that's different from just leaving the machine on while you're doing while you're watching Netflix. So I do feel like there is a work of awareness that needs to be done at the same time when you're doing eSTIM. And if you're doing it in the right way, it's a great way for you to do it. But if you're just allowing the machine to do its job, I don't think it will help you with things like, well, it can help you actually, but some people can still help with things like urinary incontinence. Mm-hmm. But for things like pain during intercourse, it's not going to do anything for you.
Can you explain what its job is then so that we have more context?
Yeah, so eSTIM, if you're talking about, the reason why I'm hesitating with eSTIM is because some people consider TENS as eSTIM, mm-hmm. and there are many types of eSTIMs, if I can say that. But mm-hmm. if you're talking about real eSTIM, the goal is to work out with your pelvic floor, is to work on and off. So pretty mm-hmm. much like strengthening your pelvic floor. Then we also have like a different types of eSTIM. And I'm saying eSTIM because it's not eSTIM, but a lot of people call it eSTIM, which is called TENS. Mm-hmm. And TENS is it's a great way to desensitize your pelvic floor. Really great for overactive bladder, really great for pain in your bladder. Very mm-hmm. good as well for people that have cramps with periods as well. Mm-hmm. And in such a way that we even use TENS for people that are having childbirth. So TENS mm-hmm. has been proved to at least seems to decrease up to 50% of the pain of labor.